Hark the hour, Rodgers and Hammerstein said of ten is sounding. George is sued by Angelina, shortly will appear. From bias free of every kind, this trial must be tried. Reverend Dr. Sonia Davis.
Mrs. Corley. Good morning, everyone. As usual, welcome. Welcome to the Temple of Light, Center for Spiritual Living, on this very, very, which one? This one, this one. This one?
Get a stool for you to stand up.
I'll have to tip the entire time. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Well, welcome. Welcome to the Temple of Light Center for Spiritual Living. That is to you who may be in the audience, hopefully very present, and those who are listening on the World Wide Web. This is a, if you hear that I go up into my head voice and sometimes slip accidentally into my chest voice, it's a badge that I wear very proudly, having been seized with a fit of nationalism on three successive nights and allowed myself to forget all the training that Mr. Dexter had given me as to how to use my voice carefully. Well, excuse me, because we know that we have all been through a most wonderful experience that allowed us sometimes to forget, to be present, to be fully present. Now, there is a sweet, sweet spirit in this place, in this land, the land of Jamaica, the land we love. We have just recently experienced the joy, and for some, the rapturous thrill, including myself, of being witness and participants to great human achievements, as we watch not only our Jamaican brothers and sisters fearlessly and triumphantly bring climax to a lifetime of preparation in athletics, but also to the many, many brothers and sisters of all nations, seeing a wonderful example of what the world is moving towards, fellowship and brotherhood, regardless of boundaries, geographic boundaries, nationalities, races, just people, expressions of God, being together, loving each other, and having a great time in Rio de Janeiro, Brazil. You know, with each performance, we could very well learn something. But I think one that stood out for me a lot was a very small-bodied, almost frail-looking woman, I'm not sure of her nationality, who was running in an obstacle race. Somebody will tell me what that was.
Steeplechase,
yes. And someone fell in front of her and her shoe came off. And she made some valiant attempts to put on the shoe. And then when it wouldn't go on, she picked up the shoe and she ran for dear life. And I think she came in, she did not win, or she didn't qualify automatically. She qualified because of the obstruction, right? But when she got the most glorious cheers, as the audience saw, how she had ignored the immediate disadvantage and focused on her goal and moved forward relentlessly. And she was rewarded. She was rewarded, as Dr. Freddy said, with being able to participate in the next round. You know, sometimes our life comes upon us by surprise. Things happen which we had not planned for. And the temptation may be initially to try to fix it ourselves. But I think This woman must have gone deep inside of her and channeled the power which said, run, run. And I think this is the way that we should face life. Instead of spending time trying to fix and manipulate conditions, whenever we meet with anything which seems like unexpected adversity, we should dig deep within. In fact, we should be all prayed up, and I strongly suspect that she was also well prayed up, as was our Jamaican contingency. Something interesting happened. I think we had the same number of medals as we had in the past, but there was a powerful energy that was emanating from them, far greater than that before. And I know it's important that we say, yeah, we have seen it. It's familiar. It's the same, almost the same people running the same kind of races. But guess what? They were looking at life and coming at it from the vantage point of a higher level of being, a higher level of consciousness. If it were not so, they would not have lit up the stadium. Wherever they went, they were the attraction. They were like a magnetic attraction, lifting people, filling them with joy. People just wanted to be around them. And I have good reason to know that they took their prayer work and their understanding that the power and presence of God was that which ran through them. I know that they did that. I followed them very closely on Facebook. Yes. And Facebook is okay, you know, right? It's very okay. It keeps you right abreast. And if you have the consciousness that will attract the most loving, positive people, every day you will be filled with that same love and joy which beset our athletes. You know, many of us, I think they were just allowing themselves to be free to experience whatever came of their events. And I noticed how joyfully they accepted what the onlooker might call defeat at times, right? The onlooker, they were just so grateful, all expressing gratitude for the privilege of being there. I never saw one person who didn't seem that they were so grateful. They were free to allow themselves to accept whatever came, although their goal was set. But there was a higher goal than just winning medals. And you know, I believe that true freedom is much greater, comes much more, it's much more than achieving a goal that one has set. Some people believe that freedom comes after the goal for we have achieved a goal for financial, material, or emotional well-being. But you know, freedom is unconditional. But when applied to our lives, it brings all these other things. So why not consider freedom? Freedom is what we have already been given, but what we may not have used fully and completely. We are here to become so anchored in that which gave us the freedom that we will use it with gay abandon. We will use it with authority to bring to ourselves that which we think we are seeking when we seek goals which are objects, relationships, and things. Even happiness that we seek comes only when we have fully used the freedom which has been given us to think, to choose, to interpret life as it comes at us, in the way which understands that the power and presence we know as God is in everything, therefore it is all good. You know, speaking of happiness, Mary Manning Morrissey said something very profound. She said, happiness and joy are not one and the same. Happiness is the elation that accompanies good fortune, while joy is the evidence of God's presence in human existence. Joy is not a destination, it's a way of traveling. So when we travel, knowing that we are anchored in the and that the presence of God is anchored in us, and we are anchored in God, then we are traveling in joy. So when we meet the happiness and the pleasure that comes from things which we call good fortune, we are not so tied to them that we fear that we may lose them, fear that we may not ever see them again, or that we are so bound to them that we forget our real purpose. The purpose is to express and to know the power and presence of God. And in so doing, pleasure and happiness comes as a natural side benefit. You know, just to share with you, the power and presence which we know as God has so advanced medicine that many of the pharmaceuticals, yes, and I know we give pharmaceutical companies a great rap, many of them now boast, they're not just bringing to the fact that there are side effects, which they must do, but they are declaring side benefits. Many of the things that are now put out have side benefits. Surprise, surprise. Yeah, surprise, surprise. Side benefits, they actually are meant to do one thing, but out of that doing, other things are corrected. When we set out on the journey of self-discovery, the journey of the self, everything falls into place. Happiness comes to those who are free. You see, freedom is our inheritance from the Most High. But we must grow into it and set liberation as a goal. We must steer our lives deliberately and consciously towards the goal. To do so, though, we must be willing to change. And interestingly, everyone wants happiness, but some people are just not willing to change. You'd be surprised how many people don't want to change. I can tell you that as a fact from my practice. They will want all the things that they say they have come to, but they want it without changing their way of life. Bob Proctor, one of our New Thought luminaries, says change is inevitable. Personal growth is always a personal decision. We're going to change, you know, regardless, but we can steer the direction of the change, and we should. We should. We can't just go willy-willy. You know, I didn't know that we still had trains coming along. But one night, very dark night, my daughter and I were traveling somewhere in St. Catherine when we heard a loud noise coming along from somewhere. It sounded like a train, but you couldn't see any train. So we decided to play it safe and stop some distance. And then we saw a little man in the dark trying to flag us down to prevent us from crossing an open train rail. And so, you know, I thought about this, using a train journey as an analogy. You know, the train, you know, and the driver and the train can be seen as part of this journey of consciously conducting our lives. The conductor has to play a role, yes. And I'm sure the conductor on that train was playing a role. But the driver of the train, driving along the rail tracks, right? The train ride is like the spiritual awakening that is taking place as we drive along. The railway is the definite spiritual practices and our use of the law of mind when we do it deliberately. And we negotiate ourselves through spiritual life at the pace determined by our present state of consciousness. We have to be always growing that consciousness by remembering who we are and affirming the presence of God, so that that pace at which we grow spiritually. And I'm going to share with you some of the milestones of spiritual growth, some of the evidence of spiritual growth. We are the ones that have to do that. Because you see, there's a flame buried deep within us that it cannot be extinguished. That is the desire to express ourselves, express that image and likeness of God, which we are. It is an unquenchable urge, which at first is only faintly recognized as such. But in responding to it, sometimes we get derailed, just like our train could get derailed, right? But in our lives, yes, we make mistakes, and often the circumstances are painful, but it only this painfulness, if we know who we are and we are aware that there's a law which responds to us when we declare and into it what we desire to know and to experience. If we do this and we are aware, it is not an ad hoc thing. We know that all we have to do is to redouble our efforts to maintain our focus, to get back on the rail of life, and to remember who is in charge. You know, these experiences that we have been having that seems to recur. I don't know if any of you have an experience where it seems like the same experience keeps coming back time and time again, and you say, oh Lord, that again, But guess what? I came upon this quotation. We know it's good to hear it from somebody who lived thousands of years before, even the Master Jesus Christ. It's Heraclitus, a Greek philosopher. And the statement may be familiar to some of you. It says, no man steps into the same river twice, for it is not the same river, and he is not the same man. And you know, it brings me to that. Every time we set out on a quest of spiritual growth, the unfinished business keeps cropping up, you know. But guess what? We are handling it differently, even if to the outside observer it may seem as if it's the same problem, or you might even deceive yourself to think, I haven't changed. How come this is coming and I'm trying so hard? You are actually experiencing it at a higher vantage point. You see, life is like climbing up a mountain. I don't know if any of you have climbed up that favorite mountain, that, well, hill, that people, I call it Breakback Mountain, that people like to go up. Barbican, what's it called again? It's Mountain Spring. I used to try it a lot once, long ago, so I've forgotten the name. But it's the kind of place that you feel like when you're going, you just have to keep going because you think, oh, I soon reach. And you keep going. But you circle round and round, and every time you come around, you're seeing the view at a higher level, and you're seeing it wider, and it's so beautiful, you're intoxicated by it. It spurs you on and you want to go more and more, right? That is how our life is. Be not deceived. It doesn't matter, as long as we're deliberately on this path, and guess what? The goal is sure to be attained by us. So whether you're doing it consciously or not, you are growing. You are growing and you must grow. But the pace at which you grow and the way in which you enjoy the journey will depend on whether you take this on as a conscious effort or not. You know, those of us who have walked the labyrinth, how many people in here have walked the labyrinth? Several. Some of you have not. I'm asking each of you to try it. To me, you know, well, at first sight, the labyrinth looked like a maze. When I saw it first, I thought it was a maze. You know, a maze, you walk and then you come and you're blocked, and then you have to turn back and go around another way. And then you get frustrated sometimes because you're like, sure, I can't be bothered, right? The labyrinth is not like that. It's one continuous path, ain't Courtney? One continuous path. But the thing about it is as you're walking the labyrinth, you have no idea how far away you are or how near you are to the center. Because it is a path that is wrapped around, it's coiled around that center. And that's how life is. We're walking towards higher and higher experiences of our divinity. And there is nobody can tell you, and you can't tell yourself by the experiences that you have sometimes, where you are along that path. What you can know is how you respond to the experiences that you are having. Get it? When the experiences come. So walk in the labyrinth. Some people may be able to guess, you know, if they have very good memories and good attention, they may be to have judged the path enough, but I bet you most people cannot say how near or how far they are just by walking. But, you know, life brings us along pathways like this. Just when we think, wow, I am this thing that has been hanging on to me, this experience that has been hanging on to me, will never go away because it keeps coming back. We must resist the temptation to say that. We know that we are on a journey, a continuous journey, and that journey that we are on, we know with certainty that every experience that we have is what is required for us to grow. We know in every experience there is good, and we have to affirm it, declare it, and know it, and accept it. And then if we do that, we will have the inner sight to begin to notice the subtle changes that have been taking place in us. And I'm going to do a little inventory and listen out for those things that you can identify with. Have you been feeling that there's a change that's going on in you, a little subtle change? You've been feeling a little different, and you can't quite put your finger on it. Sometimes the feeling may not be necessarily very comfortable, because people like sometimes to be comfortable with what they know. Do you find that you're beginning to be more sensitive about the traits that you may have, that you think are not what you would want to have or to be? You're noticing it. When you open your mouth and something flies out of your mouth that is not in keeping with what you would like to affirm, you're feeling it right away and you feel, No. That's not necessarily something bad, it ain't. It is telling you that you're moving on, upward and onward. Do you feel that in some way, when you get up each morning, you're looking forward to a better day? It keeps coming. You may not know what that better is, but you're feeling, is that happening to you more often? Or are you still saying, oh my God, I want to change that job. and I have been have to put up with them people at the workplace. None of you are saying that. You are moving on. Do you find that you are more inclined to seek out people's presence in whom you feel joy and peace, and less inclined towards, you're not running away, but you find that some of the people who bring you some energy that doesn't make you feel comfortable, you find that the telephone doesn't ring that often with them, or coincidentally you're out of charge, right? Do you find that this is happening to you more and more often? You don't have to run any of your old-time friends, you know. Guess what? Those who belong in your life will change, and the rest will find their good elsewhere. Do you find yourself less interested in superficial conversations? And do you find that some of your friends, old-time friends, are thinking, oh, she's a boring, she just wants to just talk about all these things, and I really want to tell her the latest source, right? You will find that you are no longer interested in things which are casual and superficial. It doesn't mean that you're boring, you know, don't believe them. Don't believe them. Are you finding yourself becoming more compassionate? More tending to want to look at the guy who's washing your windscreen without your permission and feeling a kind of warmth? That one. Yes. But it will happen. It will happen as you go along. And then you look out across the world and not necessarily find yourself bemoaning what is negative, but feeling a kind of warmth, a kind of love and connectedness. You know, this is the time. If you find yourself tempted to feel that the world is going to the dogs, correct it. Remember what Dr. Freddie read. And I can tell you, all the persons, all the masters have said that we are moving into an age which is brighter and better and happier and more filled with love. Trust it. And so you get busy with your own consciousness and start seeing the world more and more like that. You will find yourself wanting to do that, to pray, to affirm, and to see the beauty in the world. Heraclitus also says something that I really like. He says, even a soul submerged in sleep is hard at work, forget the hard, is busy at work, and helps to make something of the world. If you are really, really on the path, you are a radiating center of light when you can see the world as light, as love, as beauty, and it doesn't matter. You will begin to see any group of persons or individuals who hitherto you had seen in a different way, maybe a negative way, you begin to see them as souls who are reaching and trying to find their way. And you will lift them up by seeing God's presence in them. You know, the inclination to judge others will definitely move away. And you'll find pleasure in simple things. Greater and greater pleasure. And guess what? From time to time, and maybe very often, you will find yourself just smiling or laughing and having a little flash of spontaneous blissfulness. Yeah? Got it? Any of you have had that? All of us have had that, right? And there won't be any particular trigger. You might try to label it and say, oh, it's because X, Y, and Z. But there is no, blissfulness needs no reason for being. Joy is your true nature, and it will find its way up and through you. As you spend time in the stillness more and more, And as you spend more and more time practicing the presence of God, affirming the presence of God, no matter what is happening, no matter what you see, your wakefulness, you affirm the presence of God. And you know, I like what Emma Curtis Hopkins in Self-Treatment said. She said, you know, the man of religion keeps one treatment in mind constantly. He says, you know what it is? She says, that word is God. God. That's a whole treatment. She says, if you knew who and what God is, and you say it with feeling and great, great conviction, that's a whole treatment. Everything streams from that. Remember, treatment is to bring you to that awareness that whatever you are after, that it is already after you. So, wait upon the Lord. This Isaiah says, they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. And in Philippians, St. Paul said, Philippians 4, verses 6 to 9, whatsoever things are true, those who know it can recite it after me, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are just report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things. Think on these things. My beloved friends, my beloved congregants, I would like you to think on the things which keep you, your feet on the path, keep you on the rail, keep you knowing that no matter what experiences come at you repeatedly, you're always seeing it from a higher vantage point of consciousness. For you know that every experience is there to reveal to you the next step along your path of spiritual growth and unfoldment. And I share with you in closing the words of encouragement from the erudite Black American pastor T.D. Jakes. He says, recognize that you come from greatness for a specific purpose. You have the seeds of greatness in you. You cannot be fruitful if you were not seedful. Seedful, you know, not seedful, seedful. Peel back the layers and go to your core. Find out who you are there. You cannot give what you do not know you have. Go deep within and not just recognize, but experience the power and presence of God. Do it repeatedly and repeatedly. And truly, you are on the path to the freedom which comes from knowing the power and authority that the presence of God has placed in you to choose to look away from any experience which you do not wish to have, and to place in your life, in your experience, in the life and experience of those around you, your family, the world, according to how you see it, all the goodness that you have come to know as God. Namaste.